There have been big changes in Alaska's fishing in the last few years. One of them is limited entry. Alaska Review traveled to Cordova, Juneau, Lynn Canal south of Haines, and Kodiak to learn more about the attempt to repeal limited entry.
What is limited entry? Fairbankson commented that if limited entry means to keep more people out of Alaska, then he was all for it. That is not the case. Limited entry is a new method of managing Alaska's fisheries that combines economic as well as biological health of the fishery. Since the law passed, fishermen have fought within themselves, in the courts, and now in the ballot box over whether or not this latest form of government regulation is in fact a necessary evil. Dave Herrnsteen, original supporter of the bill, led the repeal drive.
It's putting us in boxes as fishermen. As a businessman, a person can only fish certain things now, and we're losing our freedom. You can't move around from area to area. You can't move from fishery to fishery unless you happen to have a permit in that fishery. Well, right now, it's just salmon that has the permanent permits have been issued so far, but there's an awful lot of dissatisfaction with the law around here. We fish year-round in Kodiak. That's all we do. I mean, I just was fishing 18 hours last night and yesterday and on our way out again now, you know, it's competition that decides who stays in the fisheries. We're getting all these permits and these plastic, like credit cards is what they are now, and you gotta have this fancy card, and it's just not necessary. We don't need it in the fisheries, and it's a right idea to start off with, but it went wrong.
Why was limited entry adopted? Proponents cite a sharply declining salmon harvest, down from record catches in the 30s and 40s of over 100 million fish to an average of 40 million fish per year today. Bob Palmer, special assistant to the governor, worked on the bill as a legislator.
It was absolutely essential that if we were to have a healthy salmon fishery, then there had to be some means, some constitutional means, some reasonable means of limiting the buildup of gear that was occurring and is occurring, or was at that time, in the salmon fishery. I, for instance, had been through the 1965 season in Cook Inlet, had seen one of the major runs of red salmon in Cook Inlet almost completely wiped out, certainly decimated, by too much gear in one 12-hour period.
Limited entry represents a break in traditional fishery management methods of maximum sustained yield, because now the state is concerned not only with regulating the number of fish, but the number of fishermen. Alaska Review asked members of the fishing industry, is this new law necessary?
It's kind of a necessary evil, to my way of thinking. The guy don't like to give up the freedom of doing what he wants to, but then on the other hand, it's a choice of whether we fish at all, I guess. A few more boats and we wouldn't be able to fish even a few hours.
The things that made this country great are not regulation by the government. I don't think the government didn't put my pants on this morning, and I don't think that it's necessary that they regulate the fishery, particularly the way they've done this one.
State Representative Ed Naughton of Kodiak once voted for limited entry. He's now a major voice against the program and is shown here at an Alaskan Federation of Labor debate against United Fishermen of Alaska Director Phil Daniels.
Simple facts of the limited entry law are that they are attempting to reduce the number of fishermen. They are trying to create an elite class, the only people who have access to that very, very wealthy resource out there.
First, as facts show, in the past, since 1960, the increase in fishermen has been 125%, and our production rate has dropped to 30% because there are just too many fishermen and too much gear.
Wealthy pipeliners wanting to stay and work in Alaska and Washington fishermen might increase pressure on an already crowded industry.
It's rather obvious to the fishermen. I mean, look at this. Well, it isn't really bad right now. You should have seen it here an hour ago. It's just about impossible the way the fleet's been growing.
Yeah, did you see the way it was this morning here?
Yeah.
Wall-to-wall boats. If we lose it with the Judge Bolt decision, the Baloney decision, in Oregon, in Washington, I'm sure we can count on, conservative estimate, I'd say 300 boats.
That Judge Bolt decision awarded much of Washington's annual salmon harvest to native tribes. According to some living, hordes of Washington fishermen perched on the border waiting to migrate north. Although opponents say that the Bolt decision is being used as a boogeyman without substance, trying to scare Alaskan fishermen into supporting limited entry.
But the
All these fishermen might result in the demise of the full-time fisherman, says Fred Lange.
The entry program, when it was brought up, first initiated, that was one of the main reasons. I mean, Governor Egan himself stated, we'll get the school teachers out of this. By school teachers, he meant everyone that doesn't earn their living by fishing.
Others maintain flexibility is a must to the full-time fisherman.
You have to have the flexibility. Mainly I fish shrimp. But now I see a better opportunity in crab, and shrimping is and don't have as much time right now. And so I want to be diversified. I don't want to put all my eggs in one basket. But what if I was locked just in the shrimp and we had a bad shrimp season? Or the stocks fell off, or the price went down, and I didn't have the flexibility to move. And so far now, there's still some fisheries a guy can move to, since only salmon's locked in. But take a couple of years ahead when everything's locked up, it could be a person couldn't even go out in a skiff and catch bait anymore. And I believe if people should be able to go out in a skiff and catch a few salmon catch whatever they want to catch. That's free enterprise. These fish belong to everybody and not just a few people.
Prior to limited entry, management of fisheries focused on limiting amount of gear and the length of time spent fishing to allow salmon to escape for spawning. According to Fish and Game, these tools were breaking down.
The time limited entry went into effect, our fleets were getting rapidly larger, and of course that meant much more difficulty in controlling the amount of fish that go through these areas. These big glacial river systems that we're gilleting off, such as here, we don't actually get an escapement count until well after the fishery's over with. The efficiency of this fleet is such that they can soak up all the fish out in this open area, at least up in the head of the canal, in a fairly short time. And really, when you have that many boats in the area, it's much more risky as far as getting your escapement through the fishery. It's a lot more iffy. It's not just a question of having more boats, less fishing time, just automatically compensates. You're actually taking more chances.
Sports fishermen are not regulated by limited entry, but they are affected by the amount of fish. The Izaak Walton League, a conservation group of sportsmen, has come out against limited entry, saying that managing fish rather than fishermen is the key to better runs. Sam McDowell.
It is not the Department of Fish and Game's fault that we do not have salmon in abundance. It's strictly the politicians, because the Department of Fish and Game have done everything they possibly can to manage the fisheries on a really, truly professional basis. When it gets down to the final decision, the one that's made behind the doors, it's made by the politicians, and this must be corrected. We have one thing to do in this state to manage our fisheries, and that is to absolutely, at all costs, to rehabilitate our natural spawning beds and set up a procedure whereby we ensure that each stream has an adequate spawning stock and protect that spawning stock, and we will have solved our salmon problems.
Another new tool in the fish manager's kit is fish hatcheries. Unnecessary, according to some, if natural fish were allowed to spawn, others see hatcheries as the only way to rebuild stocks.
Probably not to the same level that we were in the 30s and the 40s. Certain stocks were lost. Weak stocks, for instance, were lost from the fishery. Certain major stocks were knocked down very severely. And this is why we are proceeding now, of course, with attempting to rebuild through our natural stocks, and also implementing an artificial aquaculture program or hatchery program to in fact help rebuild some of these stocks, bring them back up to the level where we're talking about in the long term perhaps producing 100 million salmon again. But without a program to do this, the rebuilding of these stocks cannot be accomplished. In my mind, limited entry is one leg of rebuilding that stock.
The other leg is hatcheries. The Prince William Sound Aquaculture Association is a private hatchery paid for mostly by fishermen and canneries, and some government money. They are now rebuilding a deserted cannery in Prince William Sound and pulling eggs for the hatchery in another part of the sound.
Could you explain the process that's going on right now?
Simply a matter of shipping in two different methods. Spawn held, the fish are held in the holding ponds until maturity occurs about 2 weeks after arrival in the bay. We take the spawn artificially, fertilize it with sperm from local males, and then ship it by air to Port San Juan, trying to achieve roughly 6 hours maximum time in transit between the time the fish is taken out of the water and he arrives and is in incubation boxes and running water at the hatchery. But we foresee maybe losing all this cooperation. The donation of vast sums of money by the fishermen and the canneries should limited entry fail.
But there are indications that if limited entry is repealed, that the support of the fishermen that we are now receiving will change. How we are going to finance then the operation and the expansion of the system, I don't know.
One fact that I do know is that private aquaculture, as we view it here with our regional corporation, is going to be more effective in rehabilitating the salmon stocks in Alaska than any other source, bar none. But without limited entry, I'm sure that you will lose the fishermen's support of the aquaculture programs and thus lose the major portion of the rehabilitation of salmon stocks in the state of Alaska.
What are the evils of limited entry? A major problem is the fact that some can't fish because they can't afford the price of a permit. Only vessel operators need permits, but crew members who want their own boats, or worse, people growing up in traditional fishing families, cannot fish unless they can find and afford a permit.
When this question was posed to people from the Limited Entry Commission, they said, well, they have the same right as anybody else. They can buy their way in, but how is some young native kid from the village going to come up with $10,000 to buy a permit? This is what we were absolutely against.
So you think the bill ought to be repealed?
I think actually not repealing it, but changing it so it would allow the young people to get into the fisheries. I know in my case, if I hadn't been able to fish, I never would have been able to go through high school. We put our way through school by our fisheries program. And I know there's several other young people in the community there that are in the same boat right now.
Here I am, a proponent of limited entry, and I'm going right against my sons, but they have made it very clear to me that don't worry, they realize that the influx in fishermen is going to damage the fishery, and they have told me don't lose that bill.
Tony and Debbie Howard have had a set net salmon fishing site on Kodiak Island for the past 4 years. They did not qualify for a limited entry permit.
The licenses are going to get in the hands of people with a lot of money, and I'm not going to have a chance to do anything about it. And that's what's scary to me.
And what the heck, you know, permit in Southeast was about the price of a new pickup, so if the fishery was worth anything, you know, it would be, you know, a little more in it for everybody. A little bit more in it for everybody that had a permit, you know.
Salmon is the only fishery regulated by limited entry today. Kodiak shellfish fishermen sponsored the initiative from a fear that limited entry may someday regulate them. They rely on being able to move from fishery to fishery in order to pay for their boats, which in some cases are worth up to $1 million. Some say this cost automatically regulates entry. Others say shellfish needs regulating before that fishery is also decimated.
The offer has been made by the people in favor of limited entry to seek legislation or amendments to the program exempting those people in those particular fisheries from the program. In my opinion, predominantly limited entry right now is greatly needed by the salmon fishery. If the people in the crab and shrimp fisheries really don't want the program, I personally don't see why they should be subjected to it, and it's my understanding that a great many other people have said the same thing. So I felt that those people, by objecting to the program in the manner that they did, have rendered a disservice to the salmon fishermen, who are a group of fishermen who actually need limited entry. I think there were other ways the Kodiak people could have gone about solving their problem. And it distresses me and it saddens me they didn't make the effort to do this, because the consequences of a repeal of limited entry could substantially and very drastically hurt the salmon fishermen.
Oh, they didn't offer to pull shellfish out. They offered to pull Kodiak shellfish out, which is most of the shellfish. And no, you know, that kind of trying to make deals after the initiative
after we got the 16,000 signatures. I mean, there was no way then. The legislature had an attitude of absolutely no amendments. They had the excuse it was tied up in the courts, and it would have changed the ruling. But the thing is, there aren't any easy amendments, and they didn't want to discuss amendments. And
I think we ought to compromise. I think we ought to compromise in the legislative process. That's a far better way than repealing an entire act out of hand, because what's going to happen if we lose that bill, we're going to have federal limited entry.
So federal limited entry is a very, very serious and real possibility. And as far as I'm concerned, it could be a very much a disaster. And so one of the reasons we have to reject limited entry this year is to let the federal people know that we don't want limited entry.
20% of Alaskans make a living from the fisheries. The entire state is affected by the health and future of the fishing industry. What would happen if limited entry were repealed?
Well, I just tried to tough it out as long as I could. Actually, with the hatchery program they got going down south, the guy can stick it out. You know, he might come out okay. I'm just glad I don't have a lot of money invested in gear, you know. A boat like this isn't real expensive. But some of the guys, I see a lot of the big expensive boats for sale. They know they can't make it if limited entry fails.
The red tape, the applications, the reports, the permits, the taxes, it's just simply time to say enough. Get out of my personal life. And I think that's what the voters of the state of Alaska should do this November. They should vote yes to repeal limited entry.
I think utter chaos would result if this were repealed and allowed to stand with unrestricted entry to the fisheries.
What do you think would happen out here if limited entry were repealed?
Well, about 2,000 boats from Puget Sound would descend on us, and that'd make 2,200 instead of 200. If that many boats sat out here, if they could possibly get all their gear in the water, well, they'd catch all the fish in the total Lynn Canal, I'd say, in about 2 hours flat, and that'd be the end of the salmon run.
But I'm sure you've run into government regulations that drove you up the wall, and that's what happened to us. We got so mad at the limited entry program and the way it was being administered in the law that we came to Anchorage and went to Anchorage to get the signatures, and we tied up our boats and lost money doing it. But we just felt we had to say no.
Well, there'd still be a fishery for a while. I'm sure that the game department wouldn't allow the resource to be totally destroyed. And I imagine I'd keep at it as long as I could. But I don't think that anybody would actually be able to make a livelihood at it. It'd become a part-time moonlight type thing, I'm sure.
It's got to be something done, because with the amount of gear there is now and the way it's ran and everything, why the fish can't stand it.
Civilization is detrimental to salmon anyway.
You know, I see a need to put restrictions on fishing, you know. I don't want to see a lot of out-of-staters coming up here and depleting a resource which can be depleted very easily, and I've seen it happen. It's happening right now. But then again, this program is restricting us so much that I can't fish.
You know, you can't have a limited resource with unlimited participation.
And so on November 2nd, the voters will decide, is limited entry a necessary evil?
It's a political fact of life in Alaska that the voters in large cities decide elections. The residents of Anchorage and Fairbanks are about to make a decision which will drastically affect the future of Alaska's commercial fishermen. So please remember, a yes vote means that you would like to repeal the limited entry bill, and a no vote means you support the program. Ed?
We'd like to tell you a little about the funding for Alaska Review. The money to produce this program came in the form of a grant from the Alaska Humanities Forum. The forum got the money from the state of Alaska and from the federal government. What that means is that you paid for this program with your tax dollars. So, if you don't like the way we handle an issue, or if you did, or if there's a statewide issue you'd like us to cover, write us. Send your letters to Alaska Review, 650 International Airport Road, Anchorage, Alaska, 99502. We're going to set aside the last few minutes of each Alaska Review program to put your letters on the air, and we look forward to hearing from you. Until next month, I'm Ed Bennett.
And I'm Eric Eckholm. Have a good evening.